so we used spontaneous diffusion of helium 3 and helium 4, so where the dilution happens, and when this happens, heat is extracted from this stage, and so therefore this is the lowest stage. The amount of mixture we use is not a lot.
Hello. So today I am at the University of Stuttgart. Here I am with Cenk Beydeda. Hi.
Hi, Ranjit.
He is an expert in low temperature condensed matter physics. And what we see here, it looks like the quantum computers that you always see in this IBM or Google, right? Just the golden case system. Is it so, or what is exactly this one?
No, this is not a quantum computer. It's just a fridge. It's just for making something cool. Okay, but this is actually similar to the some quantum computer setups, because for these quantum computers you need to cool down to 10 millikelvin, and so we also have such a fridge.
And you told that it can go to 10 millikelvin. So if you compare it, we are at 300 Kelvin now, right? That is 23 degrees Celsius. And you see how much orders of magnitude went down to reach this 10 millikelvin. And how do you do that? With nitrogen, we can go up to 70 Kelvin. With helium, we can go up to 4 Kelvin or 4.2 Kelvin. And then how is this transition from 4.2 Kelvin to this 10 millikelvin? How does it work?
Yes, so we used spontaneous dilution of helium 3 and helium 4. Okay, one should know that there's two types of helium. Uh-huh. There's the helium 4, which has two protons and two neutrons. And then there's the helium 3, which has two isotopes. And the helium 3 has two protons and one neutron. And the interesting thing about those two materials is that when you cool them down, they separate because they have different statistics. Uh-huh. They're not soluble in each other. Uh-huh. So they separate, and when they separate, they extract heat from the environment.
Okay.
Meaning that they cool down.
They did not separate means similar to water or oil. So they separately stays. And the idea is that we have some material here. We need to extract the heat from this system. Now we have this thing here. Some cooling things flow by, then it takes the heat and it goes. Now the heat is taken by helium 3 and then again taken by helium 4, and that it will be emitted. Mm. Right? That is how it works. Now maybe for simple understanding, you can compare it with the normal refrigerator. Can you do it? Like, how?
Yes, okay. So the normal refrigerator is basically a reverse cycle process.
Yes.
So you put in work and then you extract heat.
Yes.
But this only works when you have a gas that you can compress. Then you compress then you decompress and then you extract heat. This does not work because we have no gas at this temperature.
So the liquid, both of these two isotopes are in liquid state and they're just flowing.
Yes.
Taking heat, removing the heat. Now, why do you want to remove this heat for certain materials? Because what we do here is studying different materials at low temperature. And what he does is with the superconductors, right? With different superconductors. And why we need to extract the heat from the superconductors too?
Because superconductors don't work at high temperature.
That's correct.
Yes, so just there are many interesting phenomena.
Yeah.
Magnetism, superconductors, maybe some special things. Also some applications, technologies like the quantum computers, they only work at low temperature. When there's too much heat in there, then it all gets noisy and then it's difficult to do some.
Yes. And also we see a lot of wires. And to understand, for example, the superconductor has certain energy gap below which it is forms this Cooper pairs, right? And what will be the energy range of these states? That comes under gigahertz or what? In microwave energy range. So you apply microwave here. Maybe you can explain about that one. How does it work?
So, okay, this goes more deep into the method. Okay, superconductor is only superconducting at low frequencies, very low.
Yes.
If you go to higher frequencies, there you can see more the characteristics of a superconductor. There's the energy gap, some non-monotonous conductivity, and so on. And this happens at the gigahertz frequencies. Can happen at the gigahertz frequencies when the critical temperature is very low.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the case for superconductors we research here in this system.
Super. Could you explain maybe the whole working mechanism of this dilution refrigerator here?
Yes, of course, I can explain. Okay, so we already talked about the helium-3, helium-4 mixture, which is used to cool the system down. Okay, and when you go closer here, here you can see this cylinder kind of structure here. This is where the helium mixture goes in, and this is also where the dilution happens. And when this happens, heat is extracted from this stage, and so therefore this is the lowest stage where this is the stage where the lowest temperature is reached. And of course, there you can't have the lowest temperature here and here everywhere room temperature. You have different stages where the highest stage has four Kelvin, and this stage has approximately 1 Kelvin. This also, okay, it's somewhat in between, 500 millikelvin, and this stage then has 10 millikelvin.
Does it mean the whole stage you can place the material or whatever we want to study anywhere?
Yes, so we can place the our experiments everywhere we want here on this stage. And for example, we can measure DC measurements. We just want to measure the zero resistivity of superconductors. Then we use here the DC connectors. Or we want to do gigahertz frequencies, then we take one of those microwave cables and we connect them with our sample. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Maybe could you explain the whole helium flow? How does it work, the helium-3 and
yes.
helium-4?
Okay, I now explain where the helium-3, helium-4 mixture is stored, where it comes through, what the cycle looks like. Okay, something one should know beforehand is that the helium-3, helium-4 mixture is extremely valuable. It's so valuable that some people thought about flying to the moon so that they could get the helium-3 from there. Okay, and so because it is so valuable, it's stored here in this tank. If we want to measure, we open this tank here. Here's a valve. We just open it. And then the helium-3, helium-4 mixture goes through this, through this connection here up, and then it goes here inside. Here, see the tube again, and then goes here in. And here in the cylinder, the dilution happens.
Mm-hmm.
Now you wonder, okay, the amount of mixture we use is not a lot. It's not much. And now you may wonder why the tube is so has such a big diameter. It is to get a lot pressure, to have a lot of force so that you can get the helium-3, helium-4 out again, and so that the cooling power is greater. Yes, and then also you can see it coming out here, and then it goes here into this trap. This trap, when operating, is filled with liquid nitrogen, and what one should know is that liquid nitrogen has a lower temperature than oxygen and some other gases, meaning that dirt that comes into this mixture, like oxygen, nitrogen, or something else, it gets liquid here, is stored here again, and then the pure helium-3, helium-4 gets out again, and we can use it again to cool down.
Oh, interesting.